Hello, my name is Alba Rivas. I am a developer evangelist at Salesforce, and these are my contact details in case that you want to contact me later. Today, we are going to see what Shadow DOM is. I'm going to explain to you how to attach a Shadow DOM tree using vanilla JavaScript. And finally, we're going to see the differences between using a Shadow DOM in vanilla web components and Lightning web components. Okay, so first, let's try to respond this question. What is Shadow DOM? Well, Shadow DOM is a web API that allows you to attach a hidden DOM to a DOM element of your choice. Let's say that we have this DOM here and that we want to attach a Shadow DOM tree to the div contents and to the span contents. You can do that by using the Shadow DOM API, and we are going to see that in a second. But first, let me explain what's going to happen if you do that. If you create a Shadow DOM, then a Shadow Boundary is going to be created enclosing the contents of each Shadow tree, and that is going to provide encapsulation. The CSS styles that you apply to the document are not going to leak into the Shadow Boundary, and the events that you fire from the inner elements of the Shadow tree are not going to escape the Shadow Boundary unless you configure them to do so. So basically, let's say that Shadow DOM means encapsulation. First, let's see how to attach a Shadow DOM tree using vanilla JavaScript. This is very simple. What you have to do is to create or retrieve an HTML element to which you want to attach the Shadow tree. Then we use the attach Shadow method. We have to select if the mode is open or closed. If it's open, we are going to be able to query the inner elements from the outside. If not, we won't be able to do that. And once you do that, your Shadow tree is ready and you can start adding elements. For example, here for learning purposes, we are adding an H1 element using the inner HTML property. As Shadow DOM is indeed a DOM, you will be able, if you configure it as open, to query the elements inside it. You do that by querying the Shadow root property as we are seeing here. Let's see this in action, taking a look at a demo. For this demo, I have created an HTML page in which we have a first element, which is an H1 that belongs to the Light DOM. Light DOM is really the traditional DOM, but we use the word Light DOM in web components context to differentiate it from the Shadow DOM. Then we have a script, and in the script, we are basically trying to create a div element, attaching a shadow to it, and we are adding an H1 element in the same way I did in the slides. Finally, we are attaching a div element to the body of the page. So here we can see that the first H1 was added and the second H1 was added too. If we take a look at the Chrome inspector, we can see that here is clearly marked that we are using a shadow tree, because we can see that this uses a shadow root property. So now let's try to do a quick test. What we're going to do is to uncomment this CSS style property, and we are going to save. We are going to try to style all the H1s that belong to the document. But look what happened. The first one was styled because it belongs to the document, but the second one belongs to the Shadow DOM tree. Remember, Shadow DOM equals encapsulation, so you won't be able to leak CSS styles into the Shadow DOM tree elements. Let's do something else. Now we are going to uncomment this code. Here we are trying to do document.querySelectorAll for all the H1s that belong to the document. We are going to print the length of the result, and we are going to print the text content of the first element of the result. Now, if I refresh the page and I go to the console output tag, we are going to see that just one H1 was returned, and that H1 is the first one, the light dome one. It makes sense because from the outside, the inner elements of the shadow dome tree won't be accessible. However, remember we have configured the shadow as open. Because of that, there is a trick that we can do to obtain the H1 elements that belong to the shadow dome tree. We can do that by using the shadow root property, as we saw in the slides. And we are going to refresh the page to see the result. And yes, here we can see that in the second case, when we query the shadow dome, only the second H1 element is returned as expected. So now let's take a look at how vanilla web components differ from Lightning Web Components in what regards to shadow dome. In vanilla web components, if you want to attach a shadow dome tree, you have to do it this way. You have to use the attach shadow method in the constructor of the web component. And then in a later moment, for example, here we're using the connected callback, you are going to be able to query the inner elements using the shadow root property as we saw in the demo. In Lightning Web Components, you don't have to worry about that because just by extending Lightning element, we are going to do that for you. Each Lightning Web Component is going to have a shadow dome tree attached, and that is going to guarantee the encapsulation of the components as we saw in the demo. One small difference with vanilla web components is that instead of using the shadow root property, you have to use the template property, as you can see in this code. Finally, I want to give you some additional notes. First of all, bear in mind that some browsers don't support native shadow dome yet, and that is the case of Edge, for example. Because of that reason, in Lightning Web Components on the platform, we use a synthetic polyfill instead of the native one. Our purpose is that in the future, this synthetic polyfill gets removed and that we can use the native one. Finally, you have seen in the demo clearly marked the boundaries of the shadow dome tree that I have created. That doesn't appear by default. If you want to see that, you have to activate that in the Chrome developer tools. So, what have we seen today? Well, first of all, you have learned that each Lightning Web component has a shadow dome tree attached by default, and this is going to provide encapsulation. Your CSS styles are not going to leak into the Lightning Web Components that you create, and your events by default are not going to escape the shadow boundary. Thank you so much, and I hope that you enjoyed the video.
Thanks for watching. If you learned something, be sure to like this video. If you want to get more content like this pushed directly to you, click subscribe and that bell to get notifications.